In this video, we're going to create the SSIS package in Visual Studio that will take data from the AF server, shape it, and store it in an external SQL database. Before we get started, let's create the database in the SQL server that we'll be using to store this data. We'll open up SSMS and connect to our SQL server. Under Databases, let's right-click and create new database. And let's name it New Green Equipment. Click OK to create the database. I'll refresh to confirm that it shows up. Great. Now let's open Visual Studio and create a new project. File, New Project. And under Business Intelligence Templates, select Integration Services. If Business Intelligence is not showing up in your templates list, then you'll need to install SQL Server Data Tools. In order to get the SSDT add-in for Visual Studio, you'll need to open a browser and search for SQL Server Data Tools for your version of Visual Studio. For your convenience, on these course virtual machines, I've included the SSDT setup.exe, which if you run it, shows that it can install both SQL Server Reporting Services and SQL Server Integration Services. Note, this is just to get the templates to appear in Visual Studio so that you can build the packages. To actually deploy, which we'll do in later videos, you'll need to install the same thing during the SQL Server installation. So now we'll return to Visual Studio. Name our project New Green Data Export. We'll select Integration Services Project and click OK. In the package window, we can see Control Flow and Data Flow, as well as SSIS Toolbox. For this package, these are going to be the important ones. We'll click on SSIS Toolbox, and we'll grab a Data Flow task and drag it onto the Control Flow. As it's set up now, this Data Flow task is going to execute, and that'll be the end of the package. Within the Data Flow, let's configure it to grab data from the Pi system and move it into the SQL Server. Double-click on it, and now we see we're in the Data Flow task. From our SSIS Toolbox, let's grab OLEDB Source and double-click on it to create the connection. We don't already have an OLEDB Connection Manager, so let's create a new one. We'll select PySQL Client from the dropdown. Put in NewGreen as our server name, and for the location, PySRV01. We'll use Windows Integrated Security and have an initial catalog of guided project. Test the connection and click OK. For data access mode, let's use SQL Command, and let's open up PySQL Commander so that we can see what the view is named that we created in the first video. We'll right-click on Boiler List and execute. And we see that these are the 15-minute time step values for all the boilers and all the plants in our NewGreen database. We remove the top 100 filter, and we can see all the rows that are returned. So let's copy this query. Let's paste it into the command text. There's no editing that needs to be done because we're executing this against the RTQP query engine. Therefore, whatever was typed into the SQL Commander can be used in this box. We'll click Preview to confirm that everything looks good. Great, we can see the first 200 rows, and everything looks good. Let's click OK to return to the data flow. Now that this is configured, let's go back to the SSIS Toolbox, and let's grab a Destination Assistant. We'll select SQL Server and New, and click OK. We're going to write this to the SQL Server in that database that we just created. So we're going to keep the provider a SQL Server native client, and we're going to enter the name of the SQL Server into the box. Enter the name of the database, and click Test Connection. We'll click OK. Now we have an OLEDB destination that we can connect from our OLEDB source. Now, when this executes, this will pass directly to this. Let's double-click to open up the destination configuration. Here it's asking us for the name of the table where we're going to store the data. We don't have that table already, so let's click New to have it create the table for us. The create table syntax was built based off of the columns that were already mapped from the source, because it knows that this is what's going to be passed to the destination. In order for it to write the values to the table, it knows already what the names of the columns should be, as well as their data type. So we'll give this a name of boiler, because this is going to be all of our boiler information. And we'll click OK. This command was just executed, and therefore if we open up SQL Server Management Studio, we should be able to see the new table having been created. tbo.boiler with columns as described in the configuration. Now let's return to Visual Studio. Let's confirm that the mappings were done correctly, and that all the destination columns match what you would expect from the input columns. In this case, everything is fairly trivial, but in a more complicated example, these may need to be adjusted. We'll click OK, and we'll return to the control flow. This data flow task will copy the boiler data from the Pi system into the external SQL database. We'll want to do this 3 more times for the other sets of data. So we'll copy and paste it 3 times. We'll rename these so that we can follow which ones they are. Now we'll go into each one, and we'll create the different tables on the SQL server, as well as changing up the views that we're using on the OLEDB source side. We'll click OK. We'll go into the destination. We'll create new and type in here. And click OK. We'll do this 2 more times. Let's refresh our tables in SSMS and confirm that everything is there. Great, now we see the 4 tables that are going to eventually have data. And we can confirm if we want that there's nothing in there now. 0 rows confirms the tables are currently empty. Now, let's connect all of these so that they pass one to the other. And finally, let's add an execute SQL task so that when everything is done, we'll get a success message written to our SSIS package tracker tag. We'll double-click on the execute SQL task, and we'll configure it to access our SQL server so that we can utilize the link server that we created earlier. The connection is just to the SQL server, and in the command itself, we'll have listed the link server. So we'll select PySRV01. For the SQL statement, let's go back to SSMS and grab the query that writes the value to the Py tag that we created earlier. That was his insert query with an open query wrapped around it. If you haven't already watched the video on link servers where we created this query, I recommend you pause this video and watch that one first. Let's execute this query to confirm that it still works. And now let's execute this one to show that the value we just wrote did in fact show up. Here we see the value that we just wrote. So let's grab this query and put it into our SQL statement in the configuration. We'll change the word test to success, and we'll click OK. And we'll connect the pump data export to the write back to Py server. Finally, let's copy this one and paste it over here, and rename this to failure. Let's go into the query, and let's change this from success to failure. We'll click OK. And now we'll build connections from each of these data exports to this write back to Py server failure, such that if any of these tasks actually fail, instead of writing success, we write failure. So draw lines like we did before, where all of them are connecting to this task. We'll right-click on each line and select failure. Next, we'll go into properties to make sure that any of these failures are treated as an OR condition instead of an AND. Great. What this means now is that first, this task will execute. If it succeeds, this task will be executed. If it fails, this one will. This task will write a failure message to the Py tag. This process is repeated for the boiler data export, to the heater data export, to the compressor data export, to the pump data export, all the way down to the write back to the Py server, which is success. Great, now let's execute the package to make sure that everything works. We see the sequence of green check marks as it went from one data export to the next, as well as the fact that this writeBackToPy was used and this writeBackToPy server failure was never used. Let's confirm in SSMS that the data was put into the correct tables. Here we see the values that we were interested in, and we can repeat this for the other tables if we would like. And we can also see the value of our tag showing success. Now, in order to induce a failure and confirm that the writeBackToPy server failure route is kicked off when it should, I'm going to start the package and then stop the RTQP query engine service. So I'll open up services, and I'll navigate to PySQL Data Access Server RTQP engine, and I'll have it available where all I have to do is click stop, and it'll break the package. So I'll run the package, and then stop the service. Here we see the boiler data export has an X over it because it could not complete, and the writeBackToPy server failure box has a green check showing that not only did it execute, but it executed successfully. Now let's go back and view the data for our tag. Here we see the status of failure. Great, our SSIS package is working the way we want, and we're getting the data from the Py system shaped into 15-minute intervals and stored in an external SQL database. We have a tracker tag that is capable of writing success or failure depending on the status of the SSIS package execution. This concludes the video for building the SSIS package, and in the next video, we'll learn how to deploy it to a SQL server.